All right, how's it going, everybody? Today, we're going to be talking about narrow AI, general AI, and in particular, how it relates to the healthcare industry. I'm here with Alex. I connected with him on LinkedIn. So why don't you introduce yourself, Alex? Tell us where you're from, what your career path was, and what you're working on right now.
Yeah, thank you, Antonio. So my name is Alex Ermolaev, and I've been around for a while working in different parts of the computer industry. I used to work at Bell Labs early in my career in Microsoft, built several startups, worked for NVIDIA, and now work for Change Healthcare, which is one of the largest healthcare technology companies. AI is actually very interesting because my original degree was in AI, and that was a while ago. And of course, I use it throughout my career, you know, from time to time. But in the last 5 years, as the AI, you know, make a very strong comeback, it's become my full-time focus. So in my current role, I am director for AI at Change Healthcare. Change Healthcare does a lot of, provides a whole range of different solutions and services to healthcare industry. We are one of the largest medical imaging software company. We process 60% of the medical claims in the United States. We provide a bunch of different solutions and services to different parts of the hospital and insurance industry. And the company is pretty large, several billion dollars in revenue. It's public. We have 150 different products throughout the company. And what we do with AI is basically we go use case by use case, evaluating each opportunity and applying AI in areas which are the most suitable for the current state of technology. So, you know, we looked at over 200 different use cases. We picked 40 somethings that might be usable, that might be doable today. We're doing about 12 right now. You know, some of them are already public. A lot of it is in the works. But the opportunity for applying AI to healthcare is kind of tremendous, and you cannot do everything, so you kind of have to start somewhere and make a progress step by step.
Yeah, is there any, with the public stuff, is there anything interesting that you guys have public? Like, I know they have predictive fall technology that they're utilizing AI for. They have, and then they've got like the camera that's able to read through the person's like, you know, the layer of their skin and figure out what their, you know, what's going on with them medically that way. And a few other things I've read about. Do you guys have anything like that going on that's public that you're allowed to talk about?
Yeah. A lot of the things we've done already announced is, we are not really much on the research side, so we don't publish papers to prove that something works. What we do is apply AI in situations where we can show commercial success right away.
Okay.
In many cases, we apply AI to existing products. For example, one of the things we announced a couple months ago is applying AI to change the workflow for radiologists. So radiologists sit in front of our screen all day long. 20% of radiologists in this country use our software and sit in front of our screen all day long. And we're basically able to change the flow, the order in which they receive those studies, radiologist studies.
Yeah.
And this particular, just changing the way things are routed and worked, we were able to show like 8% improvements. I'm basically saving people 8% of their time every day.
Okay.
And just then by changing those kind of things. We're doing a lot of work on denial. Like in the United States, the amount of claims that hospital submits but get denied by different insurance company is a tremendous amount. Like $260 billion. And we have a denial prediction services where we can predict which claims are likely to be denied so the hospital can revoke them before, you know, not getting paid for the services they provide.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
We have tools for enroll people who need all the CKP patients might not get the benefits as they have. So we have AI tool to enroll them into the right programs. So a lot of things we do are very practical and kind of like short term, something that can generate immediate impact. We're not necessarily focused on, you know, longer term research. We use a lot of it, but we don't necessarily try to prove that AI works in particular areas. We're trying to make it work in the commercial situations.
So you're working on a lot of the singular AI within the software side and not usually coupled with an associated, like, new developed technology or anything like that.
A lot of technology we use is the latest and greatest. But our focus is on applications where we can make impact immediately. AI is kind of new, right, for many people, for many applications. So if you can think about it, the AI adoption is going to happen in waves.
Yeah, that's...
In healthcare particularly, what you can implement today is like administration, scheduling, workflow, like optimize the operations of a hospital. This is something you can do with AI today. If you want to ask me how soon can we apply AI to cancer diagnostics, what we have today is just research papers. It will probably be another 5 years before we actually start applying AI to cancer diagnostics. But because, you know, writing a paper is one thing, building an actual process and product and changing the way the workflow, the healthcare system operates in order to take advantage of that type of capabilities, that will take a little bit of a time.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was talking about in my other video where I was going over basically the same thing, but related to the real estate field. So I was saying, I was using the example of like the stores, right? So it's going to be like three steps, and the biggest thing that's going to happen on the after the second step is the change of how people are thinking. So initially we have cash registers and you know, cashiers working, and then somebody's like, hey, it would be nice if this was automated. So they're doing that singular task of the electric and digital automatic checkout, and then other tasks in the store like stocking, inventory, stuff like that. And then somebody that's like the second step. And then the third would be somebody's mindset kind of looks at it from a different perspective. And they're like, you know what, why don't we reshape the entire store around some sort of software or AI system? And it's still relatively a singular AI system. It's not really that complex. It's just, then you get something like the Amazon Go store, where now they have some simple softwares, and they're combining it with the camera technology that's able to identify which item you're picking up. And then they have a few, fail safes for that and stuff like that. But it's, a lot of it's not even AI. It's just simple stuff, but, the AI comes into like the cameras and stuff like that. And then, so I was saying, for the real estate industry, a lot of people are afraid, like, you know, especially in the older generations, that they're going to lose their job, you know, in the next 10, 15 years. And I'm like, the first thing, is going to be that, you know, they have to develop the software for one and make that streamlined. Then they have to develop some sort of AI that sorts through the data. And then they've got to kind of shift their mind, and like what would happen I think in the healthcare industry is somebody would kind of look at nursing facilities or hospitals different and completely redesign it from the ground up using all of that technology. And then, but in order for that to happen, there's a super important step in between that you mentioned, which was there has to be like, you know, policy change, and there's got to be, you know, people coming on board with that. It can't just... it's easy in the grocery store industry and stuff like that, because there's not, you know, there's nobody to really tell them no. But when it comes to healthcare and real estate and law and all this kind of stuff, they need somebody to, you know, to change the policy, and they need to educate the consumers. And that's going to be the only way that you end up at that, you know, that final third step where we're able to do everything a lot more efficiently. So people, you know, at least in my opinion, I don't think are going to be having to worry about their jobs as long as it's, not one of, if you take a look at the chart of what jobs are going to be affected by AI, as long as it's not in that, immediate 5 years box, I think they're good for another, 10, 15 years just because of how long it's going to take to get everything changed.
I think AI, at best can automate particular tasks. So if you think about any job, any human jobs, it's usually a collection of different tasks. And there are certain tasks that will go away, but people will be able either focus on other tasks or do tasks that require a little bit more unique human capabilities. So I think the general discussion of jobs is actually not that different from the discussion we had when computers were getting adopted and people were worried, whether computers are going to take the job away. And in reality, some jobs become less necessary, but the other jobs exploded. So overall, the number of jobs and the skills, and we were able to retrain a lot of people on basic tools. So overall, the society gained quite a bit from the adoption of computing. And AI is going to be pretty much the same. It's no different from the previous wave of technology adoption.
Yeah, and from what I've been understanding and learning, it's going to be it's just a different way of using it. So like you said, you would, some jobs would be taken away, but you might get a different one. So as opposed to having to point and click with all of these software programs to design a vehicle, one example was that AI would be able to create the most aerodynamic vehicle or the pointiest vehicle or whatever you wanted, and you could just sit there and either, say, or maybe you still have a mouse that you're clicking, but you could just tell it, hey, I want a super aerodynamic vehicle that's a 10 by 12, and I want it to weigh approximately 12 to 1300 pounds. Can you give me, the most reasonable thing you think that'll happen? And so that'll be utilizing what people are good at, and it'll be utilizing what the AI is good at, which is data sorting and, finding, that efficiently. And as far as like spatial awareness, and then like you said, when it comes to using multiple tasks, then it's going to provide, different kinds of jobs where it allows people to be actually more creative and possibly have, a little bit more fun at their job, hopefully.
Yeah, a lot of the jobs, AI does not really eliminate anything interesting. AI is more likely to automate the most boring things that human can possibly do, like repetitive routine, something that humans not good because they fall asleep right away. And those are the type of tasks that are good for AI. So those are the type of things that will be most likely automated. And it's not so much because, and the humans don't necessarily want to do it anyway. So at the end, we're going to end up with situations where AI, just like all computing systems, will do what computers are good at, and humans will do what humans are good at.
Yeah, so let's see what else we got here. So for people that don't know, can you try to explain in your best words singular AI versus complex AI? I guess we probably should have gone over that a little bit earlier, but it's okay.
I usually call it a singular AI, usually called narrow AI or artificial narrow intelligence, and that's a technology for recognizing patterns. Basically, it's pattern recognition technology. It's been around for a while. It used to be called cybernetics, machine learning, data mining, pattern recognition. It's all kind of related set of technologies. And those technologies are basically able to find patterns in data. The other concept is artificial general intelligence or strong AI, and that's what you see in movies. So if you have a thinking machines which are trying to determine, their agenda, or like Terminators or all the stuff you see in movies, artificial general intelligence does not exist today. Furthermore, we made no progress in the last 30 years at all. There was no progress. And we're probably not going to make any progress for the next 30 years. So the hypothetical thinking machines do not exist, and we're not going to see it during our lifetime. What we're only going to see is artificial narrow intelligence, which is a pattern recognition technology. So if you think about self-driving car does not have its own agenda, does not have its own thinking ability, doesn't have any of that. What it does is it has a bunch of cameras, lidars, radars, sonars, whatever, a bunch of sensors. They collect the information from outside world, and based on the algorithms it was trained on, it can say, okay, I see a tree in front of me, or I see a pedestrian, or I see an open road, right? And this is what it's capable of. It's able to recognize what it sees in front of it, and based on it, it can go, you know, forward, slow down, speed up, right, left, and that's all it does. So self-driving cars is a good example of AI, which does not do any thinking. What it does is it collects the information in front of it, recognizes the patterns, and basically determines the next step actions.
Yeah, I mean, we already, when it comes to that too, you know, not seeing it in our lifetime, I had, you know, I had heard somebody else say that. And one of the big things is like, we already have a big enough problem just developing the singular AI, because the problem isn't that the program will do what you tell it to do. The problem is you have to specify all of the million things you don't want it to do. So instead of having to write 10,000 lines of code on, you know, one side, you end up having to write that 10,000 lines of code on the negative side, telling it what not to do. Otherwise, you know, in the example of like Google, they told this program to try and walk a certain distance, but they didn't give it the parameters that it couldn't make its legs super big. So it just made itself one giant brick and just dropped down on the other side.
Yeah, there's a lot of work. So, sometimes when we explain AI, we're saying AI is a learning systems, but in reality, AI is more of a trainable system, the system we can train to perform a certain task. And the training AI algorithms to do what you wanted to do is definitely a very big job. And in many cases, you have to provide, you know, put a lot of care into making sure it doesn't do the wrong thing, that it does the right thing, and that the data it was trained on is accurate, precise, not misleading, not biased, you know, all those kind of things. So all of those things are very important in order to build the algorithms that eventually will do the right thing rather than just screwing around randomly.
Yeah, so I was wondering, did you get your business degree or in software development, or what kind of path did you take for people that are interested in, you know, either going down the business or the software or a combination? I'm not sure if that's what you did.
So I kind of has a very interesting career. So my original degree was in economic cybernetics, which is now called AI or applied AI. That was my original degree. And then I got MBA from the University of Chicago. So I kind of have both subject matter expertise as well as the business expertise. And in my career, I did a lot of things. Earlier in my career, I was on the technical side. I was writing code that run telecommunication systems. And then I was on finance side. I was on marketing side, product development, business development. Now I am kind of more on the technical side again, in a technical management role. So I think AI is kind of interesting. On one hand, you need to know the basic concepts, how the algorithms work, how software works. On the other hand, you kind of need to understand what the implications are. For example, you know, whether the algorithm is going to work is not meaningful if it does not generate value or if nobody wants to adopt it. So you kind of, in order to be successful, you know, it's helpful to kind of have an understanding of both business side and technical side.
Yeah, not just trying to go out
there. So for many people, there are many opportunities to get engaged with AI. Obviously, if you have a technical aptitude or technical background, and, you know, the more classes you take, the better. But there are many ways to contribute to AI project, because AI project is just like any software project. You need to find your market, so understanding your market requirements, kind of product management role is there. Then model development is in a more technical role. Then there is subject matter experts. So if you have a expertise and particular knowledge of a business or, you know, healthcare, for example, if you know how, you know, let's say risk adjustment works for the value-based care, that's a valuable subject matter expertise which can be combined with AI algorithm to train AI to do what you want it to do. So, and then, you know, to bring the AI systems to market, you still need a product management, business development, sales. So you kind of need a complete set of skill set in order to be successful. Or the team needs to have a complete set of skills. So there are some people who will be writing AI algorithms, and there will be a lot of opportunities for other people to contribute in to AI projects in other roles.
Yeah, and business marketing and all of that. Well, awesome. I'm glad that you were able to provide a little bit more information on the healthcare system, AI, and tell us a little bit about yourself. You know, thank you for joining us. And I don't have any other questions. If you have anything else that, you know, you'd like to talk about, we can do that. Otherwise, I think we can wrap it up.
Yeah. Thank you very much for having me. I think AI is a very exciting field. We're only getting started. There is so much we can do, and there is so much exciting stuff ahead of it. So if anybody is interested in joining AI or trying to contribute to this development, it's never too late to join. It's a good time.
Awesome. All right. Thank you for that, Alex. Thank you very much, man. Have a good day.
You too. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.